Okay, good morning. Welcome back. I hope you are well, wherever you are. Today is June 7, 2023 in Taiwan. I've been back about a week, week and a half. It seems like a long, long time, or being in Thailand for several months is a little bit like a dream now. Today, I wasn't sure what I'd talk about. It'll be more of a free association, comments on the present condition geopolitically, a little bit, but more so certain polarities of personal process at this time close to the end of third density cycle. And I bring that up again and again: Armageddon, tribulation, end times, apocalypse, because those are concepts that I think are essential for understanding current social global conditions and our personal process amidst this collective. And each one of those terms has meaning distinct but you know, compatible or you know, interwoven. The title here is Ease and Anxiety at Armageddon, where Armageddon is not World War III, it's actually the final conflict or polarity, the final manifestation of moral polarity of good and evil, virtue and vice, positive path, negative path. Here at the end of the cycle, the final reckoning, where tribulation is the hardships of it, eclipses the pressuring, and apocalypse is the revelatory nature of this end times environment, metaphysically, that green ray is revealing, growing in green ray, is growing in willful accepting of reality, willful acceptance, unconditional accepting, very much leads to revelation of the hidden, or seeing clearly. And end times, because really this is approaching the end. Now, it there may be another few centuries, God help us, I won't be here, and the quality of consciousness of the souls coming in will be, you know, suitable to the increased conflict and or turmoil and or restrictions, enslavement, if negatives are successful, associated with final decades or centuries of the 3D cycle. We won't be here. We don't know. I don't know how long it'll last. But all of these phrases are useful to understand global process metaphysically, and then with relevance to personal process. The comments or the text that I'm working from that I wrote, which will guide my free association, hopefully, comments on personal process at 3D end times, with emphasis on the polarity or polarities of ease versus anxiety, detached witnessing versus active social engagement. Then logos and human evolutionary stasis, which was a theme that I was thinking of making as the primary topic of a talk, but I'll get into it as one element. Logos and human evolutionary stasis, the idea that the real problem here, problem and precious gift to the Logos, by the Logos, is the fact of, or what seems to me to be the fact of, a very unusual evolutionary stasis of human souls, or these 3D souls, particularly self-sabotaging. Then, careful assessment of world service and life purpose to move out of anxiety towards ease or balance emotionally beyond fear or anxiety or distress or dismay, whatever it is, as we witness the world process, we do need to reassess life purpose or the relationship between our sense of world service and life purpose, then trust, detachment, and uncertainty. To move to ease, if we wish to, I mean, some people will say you shouldn't be at ease, or it's, immoral to be seeking peace in a world of violence, because that means detaching rather than changing them, or fighting, struggling, fight the dark. Well, we absolutely have to accept a very significant uncertainty, and trust doesn't. Commonly people say trust the thing, trust the plan, or trust cosmic plan, which is really the plan to be trusted. But it doesn't mean trust that everything will be happy for everyone, or all will be well and happy anytime soon or ever, or it'll all work out in the end. Well, that may include World War III or some further devastation. And so, trust and uncertainty that may lead to greater ease or detachment, or by rightful detachment, one comes to greater ease or peace or equanimity with the burning world, which is not happening everywhere. It's mainly shown to us by our media, or open the newspaper, as they used to say. It may not be happening in front of us, depends on where you're at, but some people will say, the house is burning, you should rush in and save as many as possible. Well, that would be good, so long as you don't die in the effort, or if you wish, go right ahead. But for most of us, it's going to come down to a wise, a careful, what I wrote here is careful assessment or careful reassessment of world service and life purpose. People always ask me in counseling, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. I don't know what I'm here for. Even people who are actively helping, wondering, what am I supposed to do? To get into this, to explain or reveal the problem and possible solutions, we really have to look at the matter of life purpose. Because while I don't know if there's a should and supposed to as particular as people think for everyone, for some there is. For most, there isn't that extreme specificity. I'm supposed to be, a teacher teaching this and that. Maybe, but if you want to, go ahead, of course. But I'm not sure that higher self, for most of us, even has, or we had before incarnation, a particular specific focus, a particular social role that we were that is required to fulfill life purpose. Ra had said something like, "Love and light go where they're called, sought or needed, and called but not planned aforetimes." It was a quote, that's paraphrasing, where Ra was basically saying that not as much as you imagine. Is pre-programmed really is. There's less pre-programmed than you thought. So they also said the purpose of incarnation is evolution of mind, body, spirit. That is essential life purpose. For the individual, which el what else is there? For an individual, for the individual soul, it seems to me, the whole of life purpose, not the specifics, but the whole of the stream. Associated with true life purpose is evolution of mind, body, spirit. Okay, well, how you do that, up to you. We can't move out of there's sort of the anxiety of watching the world process, or anxiety we may feel, and unease or dismay watching world process, seeing how people have changed or people are degrading physically, mentally, morally around us. Not everyone, but many are degrading mentally, morally, intellectually, physically. That is a trigger for understandable dismay. But then there's the dismay and anxiety associated with, I don't know what I'm doing here, and I don't know why I'm here, and I think I'm not fulfilling my life purpose. Or there's, I imagine there's this X, Y, and Z that I'm supposed to be doing, and I don't know if I'm doing, but I think I'm not, so I worry and I feel upset about this. That's the second source of dismay and anxiety, is some deep sense that I'm not fulfilling my life purpose. Well, the purpose of third density is to learn the ways of love. So the particular focus of evolution of mind, body, spirit, the particular purpose of incarnation in the way of evolution of mind, body, spirit, here in this dimension, is to learn the ways of love, which means then green ray, which means then healing and balance. And so if you want well-being, you better know what healing and balance means. We need, the deeper we know, the better or more accurately we can apply those principles to our own process, right? So contemplation of principles as the main spiritual praxis given by Ra in the Ra material, not technique. Begin and end in the creator, not in technique, they said, or I remember they said. Begin and end in the creator means begin and end in comprehension and integration and then application, embodiment of universal principles of evolution, particularly then healing and balance. And that's clearing lower triad blockage and getting beyond the personal and moving out of all that's harmful to self and other and developing all that's good and beneficial to self and other. Just the first two of Dhammapada 183, 184. Avoid all that's evil or harmful and cultivate all that is virtuous and good and purify mind. That's it. That's the way of evolution of mind, body, spirit. In this density, where we do have great many polarities in play, like good and evil, or right and wrong, or better and worse, these things have to be understood to really move out of anxiety, dismay towards greater ease or equanimity. Ease doesn't mean I like it, it just means I'm not jumping off the walls like Bugs Bunny. And so, I like Bugs Bunny a lot, and Mr. Magoo. But we don't want to be bouncing up and down and all around. This polarity of ease or equanimity versus anxiety and dismay, stuck in dismay, right? It's inevitable we find, and then this is another principle, that it's inevitable we will experience triggered emotional distorted reactivity, emotional charge. It's inevitable. We'll sometimes grasping aversion, ignorance. We will sometimes inevitably fall into anger, disdain, contempt, impatience, frustration, loathing, maybe. And some people, or I'm familiar with, increased loathing of humanity. Loathing doesn't mean I want to kill them exactly. It doesn't mean that. It means I feel disgust at their ignorance and their dishonesty. Now, not everybody's that way. But if you read the news, you'll see countless cases of self-serving dishonesty, ignorance, materialist folly, and all sorts of conflict generation and missing the ball, missing the point, knowing nowhere understanding green ray or love or the nature and real arrogance. Humanity is both ignorant and arrogant. They think they're in general beyond where they are or sitting pretty, and that's why they're not evolving. That's why there's such repeating. So the polarity of ease or versus anxiety is equanimity versus getting stuck in triggered emotional reactions, loathing, anger, frustration, irritation, is just one category. Another one is grief and sorrow and grasping and desire and hunger and insatiability and longing and longing. And then the third would be ignorance or, fuzzy mind, monkey mind, dull mind, incapacity to know, continual asking of questions, circularity without going straight, circular thinking, repetitive, very boring, circular thinking, repetition of what I already know, and an unwillingness or inability to learn more, to go deeper. That's, grasping, aversion, ignorance, the three unwholesome roots. So it's the continual or regular arising of the unwholesome roots, particularly, again, anger, aversion related, grasping, sorrow, depression, depressive, downhearted related. That's all grief and grief and longing go together. And then ignorance or just ineffective mind, irrational mind, dull mind, incapable of comprehending mind, like that. Confusion. It's inevitable that stuff keeps coming up now and then or regularly. Healing and balance is the way to be free that of, increasingly free from it. But we must cut the roots to be free of the arisings. Weeds grow from roots in soil. If there's no water, if there's no root, it's not there. If you cut the root, strike the root, the arising doesn't occur. And it's not a matter, it's not that simple. And absolutely, there's only so much that can be done to cut the roots of unwholesome mental states simply by thinking or study or dialogue and listening. Actually, some kind of concentrative practice, meditation, is really necessary. So back to that. But some part of our problem, the anxiety or dismay at Armageddon, is from unwise social engagement. And this could be understood as the polarity of choosing to fight the darkness versus offering light, fighting the dark versus living, walking in love light. The detachment that would be required to move out of unhealthy engagement, right? There's healthy, there's unhealthy, there's supportive, and there's dysfunctional interpersonal social engagement. The way to move out of that absolutely requires a detachment from the weird, my window. Oh, there's some creature in my attic. Sometimes this talk stirs up the small creatures. Light stirs the under the rock dwellers as well. But cutting roots that comes naturally or slowly by deeper insight or is of insight and thus a fruit of deeper meditation. This detachment, witnessing, we have to, one would need to witness the mind with as much emotional detachment as one can sometimes witness the world. So there's the world of human collective, and there's the world of the mind. In some sense, the great problem we have is the world of mind, not the world of human sociality or social organization. And so, freedom from the world of mind, freedom from the worldly mind, freedom from the mind. I'm not free from mind, but free from the inevitable polarities of mind, particularly seeking pleasure, hating pain. It's inevitable, it's right, but there's a requirement to feel pain to release its roots. One must honestly accept the pain and then know it, right? Know yourself, accept yourself, to be free of the roots, to cut the roots, to be increasingly free of grasping for that which constitutes the roots of unwholesome mental states, such as anxiety or anger, aversion and grasping, sorrow, grief and fear and mental infirmity. They arise from roots. Those roots are not simply habit. There's also then some wrong view in the root of the unwholesome arisings, or the anxiety, dread, fear, anger, grief, pity, resignation, whatever that we may feel here at this, of witnessing the collective, witnessing the sickness and distortions of the collective, to the extent that we're deeply upset or even immobilized in some sense, that's our problem, not theirs. And so some kind of but some kind of deep mind reassessment of assumptions, presumptions is needed. I've talked about this before. We carry all sorts of assumptions and presumptions that we don't check. And so particularly associated with life purpose. And that goes then to the issue of service. Again, it's becoming more and more clear to me, whether it's true or not, that we're really not here particularly for the individuals. We're really here for the planet, and I think our own accelerated evolution in relation to our group. We're really here, I mean, we as wanderers. Ra said the first is a radiatory love light, planetary service, world service of radiation of love light by activation of higher chakras. It's as simple as that. Sixth chakra may be in play, may be activated, but has limited influence in mind to the extent that we have love, wisdom, imbalance, and deficiency. Imbalance, excess, and deficiency. The imbalance is because of an excess deficiency. The imbalance where the person becomes coldly mental and says, fuck 'em, or over-emotional green and says, how could I ever stop crying? And both of those represent distorted reactions associated with love-wisdom imbalance, too much wisdom or not enough love or not enough wisdom, that we will encounter as the time goes on. But the rectification of mind, the purification of mind, very much associated with avoiding the harmful and cultivating the benevolent, the beneficent, like Dhammapada 183, includes a reassessment of understanding. It's not simply feel it and allow it and bless it and be with it and trust the painful emotion one may be feeling at present will pass. It will, but it also may come back. But part of the reason it would come back is that we haven't purified the belief level, the level at which we have a misunderstanding. And so then we're talking about core matters, like one's own understanding of one's own life purpose. And one's own understanding of how God or the Logos lets this roll, lets this ride or continue on. The Logos supports evil, damn right, and good, and that which is beyond them, sure. Why? Well, it's also clear to me that, well, I think it's clear, that this is a singular manifestation of distortion, this 3D cycle with this group of souls, with this mix of good and evil or positive, negative. This solar system is a rare case, and this is the third act, Maldek, Mars, Earth, the third act of third density in this planet, or in this solar system, this planet is Act 3. Act 1, Maldek, Act 2, Mars, Act 3 here. Before Maldek, there was a basis for this, of course, which is the sector. And so I don't really like it, but it does seem that the Logos gains something of value by letting them continue as they are. Now, the result of it, I absolutely have no doubt, or I'm quite sure, will be the required reabsorption of some souls that have become unviable because they will have been successfully blocked from the energetic link to Six Ray in future lives, too, thus incapable of sufficient seeking to graduate to 4D positive or for get out of third density cycling. So that's the logo. So, Ra became concerned at the end of the second cycle when there was no harvest. Maybe the Logos doesn't feel any concern. Cool. The Confederation surely will, and the Council, and they won't repeat this. But it is an important outlier, it seems. So while I don't, so it's basically trust without certainty. And that's another phrase. Trust without certainty, not trust and verify, but trust. While not while ignorant, we don't know what's in it for the Logos to let this clown show, shit show, mess of human negativity continue, which is on the edge of even further self-killing, destruction, murder from Eastern European war. NATO versus Russia is moving right along, and it absolutely might end up in nuclear strikes. John Titor. Yeah, that's very possible. The John Titor story. Yeah, I think so. It's very possible. And some part of this is living at the edge of World War III. That was another phrase I thought for the talk today. Living at the edge of World War III. Yeah. We inevitably will feel anxiety, fear, distress, dismay now and then, or regularly. At the what seems to be a real fact that we may be at the edge of a World War III, and while it appears that Confederation UFO flybys disabled ICBMs east and west previously, as an example, how what they won't allow, we're not sure. There are all sorts of disputes on that. Some people say no, nuclear weapons don't exist. Some people say, well, you're a dummy. Of course they do. Some would say the Confederation won't allow massive thermonuclear exchange. And Ross said, we hope to harvest your peoples in peace. In talking about high energy weaponry, I think it was Session 8 or one of the other ones, talking about secret technologies. So I don't have certainty. Maybe some people will, and that's great. And Mr. Magoo doesn't know anything, and he ends up fine. So that's nice. But in general, I think the wise are very well aware of how much they don't know, how little they know, and in terms of where this is going, I don't know. Some people think they know. Maybe they do. I don't. I could easily see both, where there's some kind of devastating east-west conflict, global economic grid down, cyber polygon, or the end of internet for a while, or a complete tyranny system. I don't think they have the capacity for that, but they're doing all right, and I wouldn't say that they're losing. The negatives keep doing their thing. So, at the edge of World War III, has some truth to it, in my view. That absolutely, we could wake up any morning and we hear that, quote, a nuke has gone off here or there. Here or there, meaning in this country or that. Probably a false flag, maybe real, maybe not real, but real enough in the mind of humanity for the negatives who are involved in this to take their next step. And right now there's a jet flying over Taiwan. So Taiwan may become a war zone. It's hard for me. I mean, I've had the experience here many, many years. You may hear above my head some kind of military jet flying, and the people don't know anything, and hundreds or thousands are making good money from it. They don't care. And the humanity at some level is just too stupid to take good care of itself. The Arrival Part One, the NASA administrator who was an alien in human drag, said, "If you can't take care of your, if you can't take care of your planet, you don't deserve to keep it." Something like that. It's a beautiful planet. It's a real shame. Or it's, that's the difference between human thinking and logoic thinking. One of the many differences. I would say, the planet is so beautiful. Why give it to, let the negatives shit on it for 75,000 years? And the logos or some higher being may say, the planet is so beautiful, that's why it's given to them for the time. So that they can, what? Continue be boosted on their path to negativity. Yay, yay. They can increase, the logos has some problems here. And that's the talk title, Human Evolutionary Stasis. Logoic purpose, logos, and evolutionary stasis. That's part of what's singular unique here. Is you have a significant group of souls that can't get their shit together to get out of third density cycling, it seems to me. And we see it everywhere. One step forward, one step back. Two steps forward, two steps back. They do something great, then they do something bad and ruin it. Happens all the time. They make something beautiful and then they shit on it. Happens all the time. People do it to themselves. I mean, why do you. Self-harming behavior, right? It's kind of endemic, So what's up with this self-harming behavior? Sometimes it's done by positively oriented people who have a lot of wounding. Sometimes it happens from ignorant people who don't know what they're doing. They don't know that they're self-sabotaging or self-harming, actually. The negatives may think they're polarizing, but they're trapped too. Orion has trapped both the moderately positively polarized and the insufficiently polarized negatives who can't harvest a 4D negative either. So you've got a dual slave population formation of leadership and followers or masses, both under the thumb of Orion for future 3D cycles. Ho ho. So, hey, they're doing all right. Or are they? Don't know. In the end, I don't know what the Logos gets out of this. I can imagine a few benefits, but in the end, I don't know. So, but I trust that there is purpose and value to the Logos and to us, which is basically intensive catalyst for our own development. Okay. But, the logo, this is a rare situation. It's not that common. But that, it seems there's a bunch of 3D repeaters, blindly following each other into continual circular non-evolution, going round in circles, going nowhere fast in terms of polarization and moving out of third density. That you can say is a logoic issue or problem, and you can say that's associated with how special and cherished this place is, or unusual, unique, thus cherished and precious. Okay, I got that. But down here on the ground, we, I think, should expect increasing distortion all over the place in the mind and in the collectives, in the groupings. Okay, so it's not a happy picture, but it's a extremely fruitful catalyst. And so that's another part of why this, Jesus said he didn't come to the 99, he came to the one lamb who strayed, the lost sheep. So humanity as lost sheep. They're not just sheeple, or they're not really sheeple, They're lost sheep, lost children, who think they are kingpins. Some of them, some. Not everybody's an asshole, of course. It's just they're the ones leading the show, but they're fully supported by kindly ignorant people. The kindly ignorant support evil. Not consciously or deliberately, actually, or sometimes, but lousy discernment is endemic as well. But it looks like an evolutionary stasis, and while that's a wonderful catalyst for us to develop love, wisdom, balance, real maturity, to be here in without full detachment. You see, in previous centuries, seekers left the humanity quite fully and went off to the mountains and the forests and the caves. And you see it with the great teachers in Buddhist Hindu tradition. They're not really social. They're not much socially engaged. So while we are more socially engaged than previous greater seekers were in past centuries, we don't really know what the value of this to the Logos is. I can imagine a few. I can imagine some very bitter consequences, several 75,000 year cycles down the line. We can trust, I can trust that there is a perfection or justice here. Okay, it's not willy-nilly, but some no contemplation, these ideas can helpfully help can help us reassess our sense of life purpose, and it's really a matter, to some degree, of world service and personal desire. If we don't have to be involved or engaged in ways that we thought we needed to be. This is very common with people who are wondering about life purpose. They have amplified or exaggerated, they have an exaggerated understanding of the nature of their world service and think they should be doing some kind of monumental social activity when they don't need to be, and they're just fine fulfilling life purpose as they are. The only problem is they don't know it. One has to, I think, recognize that we were never here to change them. We were never here to save society, redeem society. These are grandiose imaginings. I never really had that sense. I mean, why do I do what I do? You can ask. Why does anyone do what they do? Well, it's not because I want to save the world. I just value the doing. It's good for me. And it's wonderful to me that it's good for some, too, while it's useless for most. Okay, fine. What I do is useless for them. What they do is pretty useless to me. Fine, that's the way it goes. So we're in a lower zone. And Jesus didn't revolutionize hell. And those from No Solar don't set up a permanent outpost in the lower zones, or even if they do, it's simply to help one at a time, ready to leave hell. We didn't come to this, as Ra said, adequate heaven and more than adequate hell, at least as I remember. We didn't come here to clean up hell. We did come to witness. Some souls, some of us, some wanderers came here more fully than others to witness, not engage. But we surely came to continue our own evolution, which whose primary work is to learn the ways of love here in this dimension, because that's where the real blockage is in mind, which is the nature of the veil, which is between three and four. Meaning, moving energy from root to four and then up. The challenge is getting from two and three blockage to four, which is basically deep acceptance of the personal and the interpersonal and the collective. And it requires understanding, of course. It's not just yes, it is, yes, I am. Yes, I am, yes, it is, yes, you are. Yes, I get it. I don't live in an alternate reality. I want to see things clearly. And he, she really is this way. I really have been this way. I really have this development and these blockages. Honest self-assessment, honest assessment of others, honest assessment of society. That's associated with learning the ways of love. And when that's done, we will have a reassessed understanding of life purpose. With, when the personal and the interpersonal is more fully accepted and understood, and then too, the fact of logoic permission, logoic sanction, not economic sanctions. The logos sanctions this. Sanction means permit. It's very crazy, the word sanction, maybe I'm confused. Sanctions against, but there's sanctioning of. The logos is fully supportive of all that's going on here. Now the Confederation isn't. The angelic, is in horror, but the logos permits, supports, enables. And if it's good enough for the logos, it should be good enough for us. And the problem is we're confused, we don't understand. And then we have active anxiety or dismay or disdain or this dis-ease about here. And some part of this is not simply about some part of the healing of being unwell at end times on the edge of World War III. is some deep view, what we're going to hit down the line, down in the deep mind, what we're going to hit is some opinion or some position that says, I don't want to be here. Actually, okay, the logos permits it or sanctions its continued activity. Okay, I don't understand it, but I trust that. I don't know whether it's going to go to destruction or a smoother transition. I'm okay to be in a detached position, being helpful to only a few personally, but radiating love light and doing my own thing. But in the end, I don't even want to be here. This is also growing for some people. And that's one reason that people don't look into the matter that go deep in the issue of life purpose, is they'll find they don't want to be here. They don't want this life. They don't want this life, or we, in some sense, don't want this life, for which we're trying to discover and then fulfill our purpose. I can spend some time trying to discover and then fulfill my life purpose, but actually, underneath it, I may have to admit that I don't want this life at all. But that doesn't mean that's the only view or voice. Meaning, it's not unusual that after I hear myself say, yes, I don't want to be here. I don't want any purpose in this world. Then I may say, well, wait a minute. There's a lot of beauty here. There's joy. It's profoundly valuable catalyst. It's the best little whorehouse in the galaxy. The best little mess. It's a real piece of work here. I mean, the distortions are off the chart. The distorted, the degree of distorted mind here is off the chart. Off the chart. Completely off the chart. It's unparalleled, probably, in the galaxy, actually. There's positive, there's negative, there's mixed. This is a particular form of the mixed orientation planet or 3D cycle, meaning some positive, some negative. It's this is a whole new, this is a whole nother story. Difference of degree is a difference of kind. The difference of degree between the ordinary mixed harvest 3D planet, mixed orientation 3D planet, meaning some are benevolent, some are on the positive path, some are on the negative path in 3D. This is way beyond just that. this is a singular example of the depths of distortions possible to the veiled 3D mind under 4D negative direction, where positives and negatives are both profoundly affected by distortion, if not submerged within it. And then the mass of people, the majority, have no idea what's going on whatsoever, and basically cling to human religion with no conception that there's true cosmology beyond it. So this is a very very unique, which is not quite correct, but it's a highly unusual and unique situation. And one of the reasons that people often don't reframe the search for life purpose, what am I supposed to do, to a question of what do you want? Because if you discover what you want, you can fulfill it, perhaps, and that would be some fulfillment of life purpose, actually, commonly, not always, but indeed, someone who's got their head on straight or has some respect of her green, blue, indigo will find that their desires actually significantly accord with life purpose. Even then, the person may discover, you know what? I'd actually rather not be here. So then it's back to chanti titika, patient endurance, and paramam tapas, the highest yoga, the highest tapas or austerity, being patient endurance. Okay, we don't, some people or we have some strong feeling I don't want to be here. We also have some strong feeling we want to be here, believe it or not. And you can't, that's the funny thing. You can't go to step two unless you finish step one. You can't realize, it's hard to realize that we actually may want to be here or do want to be here to some degree until we acknowledge that we don't want to be here to some degree. You can't get to the deeper until you finish with the superficial. And you can't finish the superficial unless unless we are willing to think and feel freely the nature and experience at the superficial, which is, I hate it here, or I hate them, or they're so fucked up, or da 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 da. That froth can be released, and then there'll be a deeper recognition commonly. Well, you know, it's a beautiful planet, and I feel such happiness here sometimes, and I don't really want to leave right away because I think I'll have some wistful longing when I'm gone. That's true, I think. For me, we'd have some wistful longing. I was there. Were you there on planet Earth at the 3D cycle? Yeah, I was there at the end times. Wow. All the little omelets will be interested. So, you can't get to the deeper without passing through the more superficial, which may be quite painful. So all of this is to say that one may have some trust without certainty. One may come to some balance with a continued conflicted position. I like it, I hate it, I want it, I don't want it. I want to be here, I don't want to be here. I feel love for them, I feel disdain for them. These polarities will remain, or may remain. They'll remain until we've cut the root, struck the roots, and gotten rid of the roots of all these polarities. But it's better to be in equanimity than anxiety. And yet, there's a whole lot of truth-telling to oneself one would need to move out of anxiety, dismay, distress, rightly, with wisdom. And that itself is a huge and valuable piece of work. So, trust, detachment, and uncertainty that may come out of a careful reassessment of world service or life purpose. First, life purpose, and then particularly the nature of world service. You don't have to be in relationship to do world service. The positive path or the path is not is wrongly limited, may be wrongly phrased if you think it's only service to other. That's a actually a poor choice of terms, I believe. While service to other, service to self is of the two paths, to define the positive path only by in terms of service is limiting and mistaken. There is, but it is also true of the slower way when you go with your planet rather than the adept path where you just go straight from root to crown as much as possible. We surely need to be flexible and recognize that if we remain in distress, it's because a certain piece of work has not been done. Now there's also conditions. You have a terrible loss of a loved one. One goes to distress. There's suffering, terrible atrocity going on globally. One feels distress and dismay and grief. That's not to be avoided. But then there is amping up one's own misery. So there's a difference between the rightful experience of grief and attachment to grief. They're not the same. And if you think you shouldn't be experiencing any form of dismay or dukkha, you better get your head right, soldier, and realize that it's a pain. Dukkha is inevitable. Dukkha is of avidya, and so it's of samsara and of incarnation and of the path. It's inevitable. Until we're free of dukkha, we'll be in some degree of dukkha, stress, distress, dissatisfactory, dissatisfactoriness. So anyway, that'll be it for today. I don't need to go on beyond the hour. I hope it was useful. It was a collage of perspectives. So I hope you're well and making peace with uncertainty, and certainly praying or send love light to humanity is always a good thing. So take good care of yourself. See you next time, and good night.